Venerable Ajahn Amaro is the abbot of Amaravati Buddhist Monastery in England. With educational background in psychology and physiology from London University, he pursued a spiritual search and entered monkhood by the ordination of the famous Thai forest tradition master Ajahn Chah in 1979. In October same year, he returned to England and joined Ajahn Sumedho at the newly established Chithurst Monastery. He resided for many years at Amaravati Buddhist Monastery, making trips to California every year during the 1990s. In June of 1996, he established Abhayakiri Monastery in Redwood Valley, California, where he was co-abbot with Ajahn Basano until July 2010. Ajahn Amaro then returned to Amaravati Buddhist Monastery in England in 2010 to take up the position of abbot until present. Venerable Ajahn Amaro has been a most internationally renowned Buddhist monk who teaches meditation in the forest monastery tradition with implications to psychology and medicine. He has published numerous articles in various journals and magazines and a number of books, including To Dawn, The Long Road North, Small Boat, Great Mountain, Rain on the Nine, and The Island. Now is the time for us to listen to tonight's Dhamma talk, and I humbly ask Venerable Ajahn to proceed from here.
I'm very glad to be here this evening, and once again at BIA, which I regard as a very suitable and welcoming and very helpful teaching venue here in the Bangkok area. So this evening we could begin with a period of meditation for about 15 or 20 minutes, first of all, and then I'll do the Dhamma talk after that, and then following that time we'll open things up for questions, if there are any things people would like some clarification on. So perhaps we could just take some of the lights down a little bit, and we can just spend time in quiet meditation. Well, 15 minutes, first of all. Thank you. when I came up with the title for this evening's talk. It was a few months ago, and I had no idea that this was the same time that the World Cup was happening. And even though I'm sure that not that many of you are particularly concerned with football, maybe some of you are, but this is a time when people all around the world are very taken up with the concepts of winning and losing. What's my team doing today? And even though we have our own nationality, oftentimes we can be, say, supportive or interested in a particular team, and we tie our heart to the success and failure of what our team is doing. So, if you're interested in football, I'm sorry that you're missing the games. I'm not sure what time it is in Brazil at the moment, but I'm sure you're able to watch the game later on. But even if you're not interested in football, all of us, I would suggest here, have a lot of concern, a lot of experience in our lives with the emotional impact of gain and loss, of winning and losing. So whether it's our football team, whether it's Liverpool didn't make it to the top of the Premier League, just by a whisker, they got picked at the post and our heart breaks, oh, poor Liverpool. Or whether you're thinking, Liverpool? Who cares about Liverpool? Or Brazil, or Germany, or England, or Thailand, or Korea, or USA. We can look into our own lives and see we have our own particular value systems. We can look back and see those times of heartbreak. Oh no, I didn't make it. Whether it's our football team not making it to the top of the league, losing the championship, or whether it's the thrill of success. Yes! Manchester City again. Thailand, winner of the cup. Yes! These are very basic emotional human responses. The thrill of success and gain, that yes feeling, and then the experience of loss. Oh, I failed the exam. I got fired from the job. My beloved just walked out on me. The paper that I spent the last 6 months got rejected from my favorite scientific journal. Or the publishers are not interested in my new novel. Whatever it might be, all our different worlds. You think you've designed a beautiful building, and then the client takes one look and says, oh, oh dear, and our heart breaks. So we all have that experience, gain and losing. And I'd like to offer some reflections this evening about that, so that we can have some perspective. Understand how this works within our lives and find a way to live with all of life's ups and downs, the many kinds of gain and loss, whether it's big things like the building you spent 6 months designing being rejected by your client, or whether it's the thrill of getting a parking space, yes, or the traffic allowing you to get here on time. We drove all the way from Ayutthaya this afternoon. I was supposed to be here at 4:30 and we arrived at 4:29. So I had this very clear feeling of, yes, we made it on time. It's a small feeling. But in our days, if we look hundreds of times, maybe thousands of times, we have these little disappointments, big disappointments, small and great heartbreaks. Now, when we consider these emotional events, the thrill of success, winning, gaining, and the pain, the heartbreak of loss. We see that these are very much based around the feeling of self, of I and me and mine. They're very much caught up with what Ajahn Buddhadāsa would use the Thai phrases do gu, kong gu, a kind of coarse, yeah, me, R, a kind of rough, coarse, ego-centered, and he deliberately used ugly language to point to the fact it's an ugly quality. It's a coarse, it's an unskillful quality, that basic human selfishness. And when we look at that, we see that even though these experiences are very common to us, they're very ordinary, when we remain committed to those feelings, just trying to have more experiences of gain, then we're building up an ugly or coarse, ignoble qualities, and akusala, unwholesome qualities within our mind. Also, if we that is our value system, then we find that we're living our life on a very coarse level. We're upset and angry when our team loses, when the stocks go down, when our company doesn't win the prize. We get angry, upset, we take it out on our children, on our partner. You get drunk. We act in kind of low and coarse ways. Similarly, if we our life is based around winning and getting and gaining, then similarly, that if that's our value system, then whenever we win, we're going out drinking again. Yes, we won. Go out and celebrate. They say that the record night of drinking in New York City was when Ireland beat Italy. The Irish beat the Italians in a particular football game, and the Irish managed to drink several New York bars completely dry in record time. So when we build our life around winning and losing, we tend to live on a very coarse level, which then has a negative impact on our own life and the lives of the people around us. So if we see that, then we see the limitations of those value systems, and probably the kind of people that come to spend an evening listening to a Dhamma talk at BIA, you'll probably have a good sense for this already. The others are all at the bar, watching the football on the TV, or doing other things. But if we look at this, we see the downside, the negative impact of our life tied to the value system of winning and losing. And we see this is based on very narrow, self-centered, egotistical motives much of the time. When we look, we start to explore, we see that when we are gaining, when we are winning, if we look at, well, what am I gaining? What have I actually acquired? What is valuable here? What's really worth something to me? What's precious about this? And I'm reminded in this of a story about John D. Rockefeller. This was about 100 years ago when he was the richest person in the world, the Bill Gates of 100 years ago. John D. Rockefeller, who was the head of Standard Oil, I believe, at that time. An American reporter asked him, "Mr. Rockefeller, you are the richest man in the world, and I'd like to ask you a question. How much money is enough?" And to his credit, Mr. Rockefeller thought for a moment, and he said, "Just a little bit more." So, in a way, he could see it, he could see the problem, but he was still stuck in that value system. He knew that there was never enough. Even if you're the richest person in the world, you can't even think of what you can spend all your money on. There's not enough stuff that you can be to buy, and you would run out of money, and yet you still want more, a bit more. So when we see this kind of limitation of gain, that it's never enough, that's one aspect of it. And also, when we look, we see, well, what is it that is so important to me, that my company won a prize, or that I passed an exam, or that my football team that I like, you know, won a game. Yeah. What's that really worth? What's the true value, or the true meaning, the true quality there that is precious? And when we start to look, then we begin to see, well, it's all very relative. There's a section of the Samyutta Nikaya, in the Tripitaka, called the Lava Samyutta, and it's the collection of the Buddha's teachings about gain. Lava means gain in Pali. And the Buddha gives this image, and it says, a rich person is like a dung beetle. And he's using deliberately provocative language. There might have been a few rich people in his audience, that maybe a King Bimbisara or King Pasenadi or a Nandi Sapa, I'm not sure. But he says, a rich person is like a dung beetle. A dung beetle that has that's rolled a really big ball of dung. That's what dung beetles do. They take dung, they take the waste of other creatures, the manure, they roll it into a ball and they lay their eggs inside. And the Buddha said, a rich person is like a dung beetle that says, I've got the biggest ball of dung. My dung ball is bigger than anybody else's. Nobody's got a dung ball as big as mine. You know, I have got the most fantastic, wonderful ball of dung. And is so proud and so pleased with this magnificent ball of dung that they have. So I suspect that the Buddha was kind of having a little prod at some of the people in his audience who are maybe very full of how rich they were, wearing all their best jewelry to go to the temple and impressing and proud of their wealth. So he deliberately chose a kind of shocking image. But I think it's also helpful, you know, because it's also not just, maybe some of you are thinking, how dare he, he knows that I'm one of the richest people in Bangkok. But it's not just lay people, it also works for monks. You know, you can be rich with your pansa. You know, I have 35 pansa as a monk. I've got more than these guys. But less than me, you know, I've got the most. So even monks can have our own ball of dung. Or the titles, you know, you're a prakru or chakun. You can be the abbot of a big monastery. Let's say Amaravati is the biggest Theravada monastery in Europe. My monastery. I've got a really big ball of dung. So when we see that what we gain, when we look at the value system the Buddha was pointing to, a dung beetle is proud of its ball of dung. You know, a stockbroker is proud of their portfolio. You know, a professor is proud of the number of papers they have published. You know, an author is proud of the books they've written that have got awards. Yeah, a parent is proud of their children and the academic achievements of their children, and so on and so on. So when we look at it like that, when we see that what the Buddha was pointing to, that winning, yes, there's a thrill to it, there can be a pleasure to it, but also there's a downside. You know, we can recognize it's just a title, it's just a monastery, it's just a few years in the robes, it's just a ball of dung, and it's just a pile of money. So what, really? And it's to help us to see that so what in our heart, that the Buddha offers these teachings. Because along with the thrill of getting, of acquiring, what's called the asada, there's the adinava, which is the downside, which is once you've got your achievement, once you've got one Nobel Prize, then you feel you've got to get a second one. Or once you have 15 books published, you see the other guy who's got 18 books published. you want to get more than the other. You want to be, say, your peace is not big enough, like John D. Rockefeller. So then the Buddha taught you, there is the downside. When you have gained, when you've acquired, when you've got, then you've got to keep it. You're locked into that value system, you carry it around, and that limits you. And also, there's that in your heart which is not satisfied by it. There's the adinava, having bought yourself a brand new Series 3 BMW super duper car that's cost you, you know, 3 million baht. Now you've got to look after it. You've got to stop people from damaging it. You've got to worry about where to park it. Is it a safe place to park it? Because it's worth so much money. You've got an old clunker with dents and scratches, you don't have to worry. So the adinava is the downside of gain. And then the Buddha taught about the nisarana, or the way of escape, which is seeing how all of this works. Seeing that value system taking shape and seeing that we can free the heart from those coarse value systems. And considering loss, yeah, we might think the losing or things not working or not having is a bad thing. And we talk about losing as a painful experience. But when we look again, as we see the limitations of gain and winning, we see there are also some blessings to loss, to going without. For example, the paramita of nekama, renunciation. Yeah, this is one of the qualities, the spiritual qualities that the Buddha required, that he developed in his many, many lifetimes. The whole of monastic life is based upon nekama, renunciation, siyasala, letting go of having many possessions. So monks, they're deliberate losers. We have no money. We're completely broke. I haven't had any money for 35 years. So financially, I'm a total failure. At least I don't have any debt. But I'm a financial failure. But that's deliberate. Yeah, I've deliberately gone without money. So the life of renunciation is a deliberate losing, if you like, a deliberate letting go. And this is a spiritual training. The learning how to, say, live simply, to live in a way which is, say, is modest, is harmless, is respectful of other beings, renunciation of listening to music or seeking entertainment, wearing decorative clothing, trying to attract other people, not playing games, not watching football. This is all renunciation. And we can think of it as a state of loss, or like, wow, you're going without all these things, you know, no sex, no supper, no football, no movies, no iTunes. And that, wow, you must be in such a state of hunger, going without all these things. But when we reflect upon the Buddha's teachings, we see that renunciation is not about learning to just grit your teeth and go without the things that you really need. Instead, it's ways of helping us to discover our intrinsic wholeness, our inner completeness, if you like. So in this respect, there's a particular teaching I like to recount of the Buddha called the Uposatha Sutta. This is in the Anguttara Nikaya, in the Book of the Eights. And the Buddha says, he's describing his thinking when he invented the eight precepts that sent back as a form for the lay community. So this is an unusual teaching in that it's just the Buddha describing his own pattern of thinking. So it's not in respect to a particular question or occasion when people came to see him, but he's just describing what his method of creative thought was. And at that time, he was considering what would be a good way for the lay community to train themselves to have as a weekly observance, just like other religious groups do. And he thought, all their lives, from the time of their enlightenment until the end of their life, an arahant never deliberately takes the life of another living being. So wouldn't it be good for the lay community who gather in the temple on the moon days to refrain from taking life of other creatures? And in that way, they will live as the arahants do, and that will be for their long-lasting welfare and happiness. So that's the first precept. It's not like you want to kill things and you're stopping yourself from it. It's more like you're acting like the arahants do, so that you're looking into your heart for that place which is incapable of violence, that in you which respects and loves the lives of all other beings, and you're learning to live informed by that intention, by that attitude. Just as an arahant cannot physically harm or kill another creature, the hand cannot move to squash the ant, it can't do it. So there's something in us that also recoils, draws away from harming. So too with the other precepts. All their lives, the arahants never take what is not given to them. Wouldn't that be useful for the lay community to take this on? And in this way, they will live as the arahants do. From the time of their enlightenment until their death, an arahant refrains from any kind of sexual activity. And so for the lay community, wouldn't it be useful for one day of the week that they adopt this conduct, brahmacharya, and in that way they will live as the arahants do, and that will be for their long-lasting welfare and happiness. So there is that in us which is completely uninterested in sexual activity that relates to other beings, other people, in a relationship of being to being, friendship, kalyanamita. There's a respect like sister to brother, and parent to child, that sexual desire does not apply. It's not relevant. There's no traction, no place in the heart for that. So when we take on the brahmacharya precept, it's finding that place in our heart which is not is incapable of relating to another being in a sexual way. That just like you wouldn't look at a spider and think, "Oh, interesting." I don't know anybody who's ever been sexually attracted to a spider. But in the same way, to have that same kind of, why would you look at another person that way? That there is, in everyone's heart, there is that quality that is free from that that pull, that force. So when we take on the brahmacharya precept, rather than wanting to have sex and see people in a sexual way and kind of stopping yourself from it, instead it's drawing upon that pure heart that is already free from that kind of compulsion, that pull. And so too with the other precepts. So the other renunciant precepts, like refraining from eating in the afternoon and the evening, say the arahants only eat in one time of the day, and they refrain from eating at other times. So refrain from singing and dancing, adornments and amusements. They're not interested in that. There's part of our life that doesn't want to just eat for the sake of amusement. They're just, you don't go to visit petrol stations just for the fun of it. You don't want to go and snack at the Esso station or the Shell station or the BP station just for a snack. You go there to fill up your car. So in the same way, you can relate to food. Like you fill up your vehicle and just let the vehicle run. Relate to food in a much more simple, natural, direct way. Similarly with entertainment, there's part of us that doesn't need to be distracted in order to be happy, that we're content, we feel whole, we feel complete within ourselves, we don't need to decorate the outside or fill our senses. So in this way, you can see that going without or loss can have very many benefits to it, that we actually, what might look from the outside like losing or not having or going without, there can be things that are very, qualities that are very helpful in that. And also the Buddha's teaching was to reflect upon any kind of gain that we do have, or anything that we feel we do possess, to consider as one of the day's five subjects for frequent recollection. You know, all that is mine, beloved and pleasing, will become otherwise, will become separated from me. This is, you know, that we chant, you know, regularly in the Bali, the recollection we bring to mind that everything that is precious to us, it's going to change, it's going to disappear, we can't keep it. And this is not because of lack of appropriate insurance policies or not having good enough locks on your doors. It's because everything goes. Sabbe sankhara anicca. Everything, all things are in a state of change and decay. So they leave. So the Buddha encourages to remember, we're of the nature to age. Jarada momi jarada natito. We are of the nature to sicken. Vayadi namomi vayadi natito. We are of the nature to die. Marana namomi marana natito. Sabehi ne piehi. Everything that is dear to us will leave, will change, will go. And it's not because something has gone wrong that we need better locks, we need more secure relationships and commitments, we need better insurance. No, it's because that's the way the world is. And it's because no thing, material or mental, it belongs, is a self or belongs to a self. And when Ajahn Buddhadāsa would talk about the Buddha's teachings on emptiness, my memory is he would always point out that when the Buddha used the word sunyata, say emptiness, or sunya, empty, most of the time what the Buddha meant was empty of self and what belongs to a self. So if my watch is empty of self or belongs to a self, this isn't really my watch. Lupo Sumedho gave this to me about a month ago. So at the moment, this is mine. But I might lose it, or I might get it stolen, or it might get burnt, or get lost, or someone might steal it. But it's going to change. We will become separate one day. Not because anything's gone wrong, but because that's the law of nature. So when we see things in that way, everything, all things are empty of self and what belongs to a self, then we see that, well, there's no person that could own or gain anything anyway. And also, there's no person who can lose anything anyway. So, what we're doing here is we're changing our relationship to gain and loss, winning and losing, from a person-centered perspective to a Dhamma-centered perspective. And in this way, we recognize that rather than, yes, I've won, or oh no, I've lost, rather we recognize, oh, this has the flavor of gaining. Okay, that football team that I like has won. There's a sweet feeling. The football team I like has lost. There's a bit of feeling. It's a feeling, that's all. Feelings come and go. Now, obviously, some gains and losses are more important and heavier weight. Someone dear to us dies, or that there are issues and situations that involve the lives of many people, the comfort and freedom of many people. These are bigger issues. But when we see them from a Dhamma perspective, we are also not just able to notice that there are these feelings of gain and loss, but it also frees the heart to be able to respond to gain and loss, to sweet feelings and bitter feelings in a more mindful way, able to relate with more mindfulness and wisdom. When we look at this, so say we take some action and we see that it succeeds. We do something, we write a book, and it does get published and wins prizes. But, oh, that's a sweet feeling. But rather than getting drunk on the sweet feeling, we recognize this is a sweet feeling. And now, me having won this prize means that 158 people didn't win the prize. So let's not gloat. Let's not kind of get too proud of me winning, because next year somebody else will win. And I can feel, rather than feel jealousy for them, I can practice mudita also for the people who won before. So when we succeed, then we recognize this is a sweet feeling. But let's not get drunk on this, and let's see if I can use this success, this blessing, in a good way. Well, rather than trying to cling on to it and own it and say, you know, look at me, am I special, am I wonderful? But rather, okay, well, that's a sweet feeling. I wonder what will happen next. And what does this say to me about what direction to take from here? Now, this has worked, that went in a good way. Okay, now let's learn from that. Similarly, when you make a choice, you publish your book, or you produce your new building, or you send your kid to a particular school, and you think, great, that's going to be the perfect place. Well, this is I'm really proud of this building. Then the client rejects it, or the kid gets thrown out of the school in the first week. The one time when I did publish a book, but very interesting, this, as an example. So I did this book, and I thought, if I don't do anything else with my life, I'm really pleased that I've done this particular book. I think I've put every ounce of wisdom that I possessed into this. And if I die today, my life will not have been wasted. I really feel happy about what has gone into this book. Yeah. Then the first feedback I got about the contents of the book was that, well, we're really concerned about all of your wrong views, Ajahn. And there's this whole list of complaints and criticisms from other monks about all of the misunderstanding and wrong views that I put into this book. And I've written quite a few books, as our friend was saying. And that's the only one that was ever criticized in that way. So the one that I said, yes, I feel really proud about this, was the one that people said, no, we didn't like it. And went and wrote a long letter to me, telling me all the reasons why they didn't like it. So, oh, that's interesting. The one thing I was proud of, and thought, my life is not being wasted. People said, yeah, you're setting everyone down the wrong track with this book, so you've really done a bad thing here. So, when we fail, when things go wrong, then rather than complaining about all those monks who think you've got wrong view, what's wrong with them, or kind of falling apart, feeling unhappy, oh, what have I done, oh, this is terrible. In a sense, getting drunk on the feeling of failure. Instead, we recognize, oh, well, this is a bitter feeling. That one didn't work. Okay, that's a disaster. Now, what does this teach me? Rather than trying to get away from that feeling, or blame somebody else, or feel self-hatred, okay, that really didn't work. Now, what do I learn from that? So this is taking a Dhamma-centered perspective to gain and loss, so that we make our primary concern, what can we learn from this? Because also, as I said, when you win the prize, 150 people don't win the prize. When you get the job, 150 or 1,000 people didn't get the job. So how many of us think about when we find a parking space, oh dear, I'm terribly sorry, I'm taking up this space for all these other good people who could make use of this. When we get to a green light, we don't think, oh, how unfortunate, all those good people have to stop for the red one. We think, great, green light. Right? When we are stuck in traffic, then, oh no, we're stuck in traffic. We have a traffic jam going up to Ayutthaya, a traffic jam coming back from Ayutthaya. Will we make it in time? All these cars are in my way. How many of us think, oh dear, I am being trafficked for all these good people who have important places to go? How unfortunate, I am obstructing these people. If only I wasn't trafficked, getting in their way. How many of us think like that? But if we change our perspective to from a self-centered view to a Dhamma-centered perspective, then you start to notice these things. Well, I'm glad to get this parking space, I'm glad to win this award, I'm glad my kids won the top prize, but let's look at the whole picture. So it doesn't mean to say that you don't park your car, but you make things more difficult, but you're, in a sense, broadening your perspective so that your life is not dominated by trying to get what you want and pain and resentment for not getting what you want. Another aspect of this I'd like to share is, and in a way, this is what, when we talk about the practice of the middle way, this is this kind of quality of moving to a Dhamma-centered perspective, I would say, is the same thing as practicing the middle way. When the Buddha describes what the middle way is, say in his first teaching, the Dhammacakka Avattana Sutta, he says, what is the middle way? This Eightfold Path, Arya Athangika Magga, the Noble Eightfold Path is the middle way. And probably most of you know this is right view, Samadhi, Samasankapo, right intention, right right speech, Samavaja, Sama Kamanto, right action, right livelihood, Sama Ajivo, Sama Vayamo, Sama Sati, Sama Samadhi, right effort, right mindfulness, right concentration. Now, I'm not sure of the way that word comes across in Thai, but Sama is usually translated into English as right. And so Sama Ditti, right view. So when we hear that in English, we assume that's right as opposed to wrong, correct as opposed to incorrect. But the English word right doesn't just mean right as opposite to wrong, it also means upright. So it means like when something has been righted. So my clock is lying on its back, and now I've righted it, it's standing up. So it's upright. So that's also the meaning of Samma is more accurate as it's being righted, as being balanced. Or you can also say attuned. Samma also is related to the musical term for being in tune. Like in playing music, the instruments of the orchestra are in tune with each other, or the strings of a violin or guitar are in tune with each other. So when we practice Samadhi, Samasankapo, Samavacha, Samakamato, and so on, that's attuned view. Our view is in tune with reality, in tune with Dhamma. Our speech is in tune with Dhamma. Our intentions, our actions, our work is in tune with Dhamma, in tune with nature, is harmonious with the way things are. So this is what we mean by the middle way, is that quality of being in tune, letting go of the self-centered view and bringing our heart in tune with Dhamma, in tune with reality. So then the last things I'd like to share then is also when we speak and consider winning and losing. How many of you, say, 10 years ago, you did win the prize, you got the promotion, your child did get accepted to that good school, or you opened that wonderful new Buddhist center, where you got, you had a marvelous meditation experience. Yeah. All different kinds of success. But 10 years ago, you had some kind of wonderful experience. Yes! And then, in the years following, you began to realize, that was the worst thing that ever happened to me. So, I don't need a show of hands, but if you consider how many of you have had that experience, something that you were celebrating, getting married to someone, getting a job, yes, fantastic. Yeah. Meeting your Ajahn, like becoming a looksit of this Ajahn, yes. And then 5 years later, boy, was that ever a big mistake? What the heck was I thinking? Yeah. I can't believe I was celebrating that. right? So it changed. Right? Things that we thought were wonderful, were marvelous, were a great achievement, that we were so proud of, 10 years later we realized that was the worst thing that ever happened. That was a disaster. And even though it might have been something that was very beneficial, maybe we grasped it and got really drunk on it. And so that it was something that was very wholesome, very good, but we made a real mess of it by the way that we handled it. Similarly, the other side of the coin, if you think back, something that at the time was a disaster, you know, some terrible illness, or you got kicked out of a job, or you launched a project and then ended up losing millions of baht, and it was your fault. and yet, 10 years later, you think, well, I didn't realize it at the time, but that failure, that thing that caused the company to go belly up, as they say, that was actually the best thing that ever happened to me. Sometimes even diseases, terrible illnesses, you know, that we would never choose to get, that they bring lessons with them that are incredibly valuable, that we learn things, we grow up, we develop maturity in ways that we could never have imagined. So we might realize, oh, I would never have chosen to have my partner die, or to get that illness, or for that whole thing to fall apart, but I really learned so much. It made me grow up, and I understand life so much better because of that. But I called it a disaster, but now I see it was an incredible blessing. So that this is something to bear in mind, that things create their opposites. It's a little slogan I like to use. Things create their opposites. And so that when you are busy celebrating some wonderful new event, and think, this is great, this is fantastic, now we've really got it, then to consider, well, in the future this could turn into its opposite. So it doesn't mean to say you just run away or you ignore that, but it means, okay, let's bear that in mind. I'm celebrating now, I think this is a good thing, but let's see what else comes with it. Let's consider this with the understanding that I will see it differently in the future. Similarly, when things really fall apart, when you get criticized or blamed, or your marriage breaks up, or you get ill, or your ajahn disappoints you, then to see, okay, well, I wouldn't have chosen this, but what will this bring? Maybe there'll be some important lessons that I learn from this. I'll be forced to grow up and not depend on the ajahn always being there to make me happy all the time. I have to learn to fly by myself. So these are valuable principles that I've reflected on over time, and I feel is very useful to consider, to reflect upon. And so now I've shared a few thoughts and considerations with you, and would like to open things up so that if anybody has any questions or things you would like to have clarified, I think there's a microphone that can be passed around because the acoustics in here are not great. So if you can wait for a microphone and then speak through that, I'd really appreciate it.
This question is a little bit off-topic from the winner or lose game, but I was wondering if you could please explain what a prap sodaban is and how one can become one. Thank you.
Well, that's a little off-topic, but not completely, because the first obstruction to becoming a prap sodaban is sakaya ditti, self-view. So, as long as we think in a self-centered way, means attachment to the body, attachment to our personality, as long as I really believe I am a human being I'm English, I'm a man, my name is Amaro. As long as I take the biography to be absolutely true, then young get to it. I'm still clinging to Sakkaya Ditti. The word Sakkaya Ditti means the view, Ditti, Sa, the true or real Kaya, body, so the view of the real person. Now the English word person, interestingly, comes from the Latin word persona, and that's made of two parts, per, which means through, and sona, which is sound. So the persona is the mask that an actor would wear in the Greek or the Roman theatre. It's a mask. So the right there in the English word person is a clue. The person is a mask. So that maybe they had some insight into Sakkaya Ditti, because that, in a way, as long as we identify with the mask, I think that's who we really are. I really am a man, I really am a Theravada Buddhist monk, and my name is Amaro, I was born. We take those to be absolute truths, then we're identified with the mask and our heart is still confined. And so that there needs to be that recognition, understanding that the name we have, the nationality, the age, the gender, the qualifications, these are all convenient fictions. They're just ways of speaking. They're not absolute truths. So again, there's something in our heart that recognizes, yeah, that's right. There might be a lot of thoughts that go, well, wait a minute, no, I mean, you mean he's not a man, or he's not English? He sounds English, or kind of English. Yeah, but surely he's a Theravada, he's not a Mahayanist, is he? But there's also part of our jitta, the banya, that recognizes, yeah, and I can say I'm 57 years old. That's just a convention, a number that comes from the number of times the earth has spun around the sun. What does that mean? Yeah, we call today the 23rd of June. That's just an invention. The word June is a Latin word. 23. Why has this month got 23 days? Some months have 28, some 30, some 31. We create these conventions and we say, ah, but today is June the 23rd. But in New Zealand, it's not. It's already June the 24th. In Brazil, it's early morning. They're not playing soccer yet. They're still having breakfast. Yeah. So, yeah, what time is it? So, there's something in us that recognizes, hey, yeah, time, place, name, nationality, these are all just conventions. So the second obstruction to Sodapan is Sila Pata Paramasa. So that, literally it means the clinging or attaching to Sila or religious observances or actions with the belief that these are true and real in the same way. So Sakkaya Ditti is like attachment to personality, to your body. Sila Pata Paramasa is attaching to social conventions. So that it's the attachment to say, oh, you know, you shouldn't point your feet at the Buddha. Well, if you're a Buddhist, that's true. But if you're a Christian, it doesn't have any meaning for you. You know, if you're a communist, it doesn't have any meaning for you. Yeah. For a Christian, yeah, having an image of Jesus nailed to the cross is very important. That's a precious and a sacred image. To a Buddhist, a man nailed onto two pieces of wood? Ugh. Yeah. Why should that be inspiring, seeing someone being executed? That's just a cause for compassion or sadness, but it's a different convention. For Christians, no, it's inspiring, it's important, it's good. So, you know, for Muslim to have any image at all is, you know, pitminai, pitsin. Because they have a rule about having no images. You can't possibly represent Muhammad or Allah in any kind of picture. Pitsin. Whereas, you know, for Christians, you can have painting of God creating Adam on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel in the Vatican, you know, no problem. So, Sila Pata Paramasa is the attachment to say, no, pointing your feet at the Buddha really is wrong for everybody, everywhere in the universe, that's wrong. And then to say, well, actually, that's just our Buddhist convention. For us as Buddhists, that's really, yeah, really a course and shouldn't be done. But that's our convention. It's a human agreement. It's not an absolute reality. So, it also, this area that Lumpur Chah would point out, it's not just religious convention, it's also like the side of the road that you drive on. In Thailand, we drive on the left. In England, we drive on the left. In France, you drive on the right. In America, you drive on the right. Which is the correct side of the road to drive? Left or right? Depends which country you're in. If you drive on the right in Thailand, you get a ticket. You drive on the left in America, you get a ticket. Yeah. So, you see that these are human agreements, and that there can be no no absolute essence there. That's Sila Pata Paramasa. Or Lumpur Chah would talk about money. See, money is a human agreement. Take a piece of paper and you have particular ink marks on it, you say, this is 10 baht, this is 100 baht, this is 1,000 baht, according to the pattern of the ink on the paper. But it's just a piece of paper. In the English money, it says, I promise to pay the bearer, one who's got the piece of paper, on demand the sum of 10 pounds, or 20 pounds. So, right there, it tells you, this is an agreement. But our convention is, no, that's 100 baht. That's 1,000 baht. Yeah. That's worth more. It's only worth more because of our agreement. If they change the currency, then the old baht becomes worth nothing. You use it for wiping the sink, clean the windows, because it's just a piece of paper again. They change the money. So, The third obstruction to Sodabhan is doubt, Vichikicca. So getting beyond doubt. It's not about doubt about what to have for supper after the Dhamma talk, or doubt about who's going to win the football match today. It's a doubt about what is the path and what is not the path. So we might see the Buddha's explanation, yeah. Makpan is this, the Eightfold Path is this, but it's more recognizing within your own wisdom, saying, this is what the path is, this is what I have to do, this is the essential thing, the rest is extra, this is it. And without any doubt, this is what I have to do. It doesn't mean that you've done the work, you've still got a long way to go, but there's this recognition that this is the direction, this is where I have to go. If I want to get to Ayutthaya, this is the way to go. And Vichikicca is the third of the what they call samyojana, the things that obstruct enlightenment. So the first, Sakkaya Ditti, is difficult enough for most people. So I would encourage just concentrating on that, to recognize that, you know, the idea, I am the body, I am the personality. If you can see that that is just a convenient fiction, then you're on the right track. Any other questions? I need some time. All doubts are finished.
Anything to share or any other questions?
Yeah, I wanted to ask about the theme of letting go of your sense of your autobiography, your sense of self, because you know, it's something I've been hearing about ever since I started studying Buddhism, but it seems like, how is it possible to really do that all the way completely? How can you let go of yourself? I'm Joe, you know, I live in Bangkok, I'm from New York, I'm married to so-and-so, you know, I'm a writer. How could I really completely let go of that? Is it really possible? Is it just like a manner of, that's the ultimate goal, but it's impossible? Is it really possible to get there?
Well, I'd say it's definitely possible. But it's also important to understand that letting go of personality isn't about trying to not be a person. It's more like recognizing that these, being Joe from New York who lives in Bangkok, that's a performance. It's a mask. You know, and that one of the interesting things when you go and visit the great Ajahns is that they're all personalities. But they're not afraid to be totally who they are. And that there's a kind of relaxed quality with them just being the character that they are. So if you visit, you know, these are the Ajahns of the old days. So, he was extremely calm and gracious and regal. There's a kind of extraordinary sort of softness that people would say when they met him, like the most sort of noble and pure-hearted king. And when you would meet Ajahn Mahabua, is that people say it's like meeting a kind of retired boxer. Like he's very punchy, and all his Dhamma talks are about whacking the kilesas and knocking him down so they have to be carried out of the ring. Yeah, yeah. And that the kind of character, the personality, is very much there. Lumbu Cha was very witty, and so he was incredibly quick-minded with plays on words and being able to tell kind of marvelous stories and come up with very compelling images and use great puns, often in the Isan dialect that I could never understand. Everyone would start laughing. But there's this marvelous way where these great beings are both completely who they are, but not hanging on to that. And you find that also in the suttas, when all the great disciples, it's not like a kind of monoculture, that all of the great arahants are the same personality, but, you know, Mahakasapa is a sort of stern ascetic. Yeah. Ananda is the kind of fussy upatak, the kind of attendant who's always taking care of everybody, looking after everyone, and incredibly kind and thoughtful and attentive, and is always looking after everything. And Sariputta is the kind of clear-minded, analytical, genius, explicator. Moggallana doesn't give many verbal teachings, but he's the kind of psychic warrior who's able to kind of wander off into all sorts of different realms. And each one has a unique character, and they're not afraid to display those characteristics. And yet, they're all arahants. They've let go of those personalities. So it's, in a way, the allowing your personal characteristics to function freely, but without attachment, without embarrassment, without inflation. So you're not trying to hide the fact that you're Joe from New York, but it's not who you really are. So you can let the performance happen, but with sincerity, and yet without attachment. So you can, play the role, but also not be confined or defined by that. Does that make sense?
Well, it sounds a little like the Zen paradox. You have to let go of yourself to find yourself. You have to find your true self, but in order to do that, you have to let go of who you think you are.
Exactly.
And so,
as soon as I let go of being Amaro, I can really be Amaro. just get out of the way. That's how it works.
Thank you.
Thank you for your help. I have a question which kind of relates, perhaps more focused on the kind of part of the middle way. So, thinking about winning and losing, I guess I just recently moved to Bangkok, and one of the things that's kind of I've been engaging with sometimes, I consume. So, in terms of food or thoughts or music and where these things come from. And so when I'm eating the food, I'm thinking who and how they come to my plate. And this is one thing which I really I guess I've been troubling me a lot. How that many people lose and win in some sense in what I consume. So there's a lot of potential suffering in the way that food is produced or for it to arrive at my plate. And so I guess what I'm asking is when you kind of start to engage with kind of the long processes and what comes to hold you in your place, how do you find a way to kind of be kind to yourself or really appreciate that many people are losing and winning based on many actions you're choosing, or if that makes sense?
I think so. These are issues that I puzzled about a lot from many years ago. I feel that the best answer is that you do the best you can. The main thing is to let go of self-centered concerns and be considering, this food didn't just sort of magic itself out of the air, it came from different places. The other thing is the vehicles that brought us here, the people who put up this building, where the electricity came from, this lighting, that you can hear this voice because of people who put this microphone together, probably in China. The people who dug the cement out of the ground to put up this building and so on. There's, everywhere you look, there's a web of involvement and engagement. And if you start out with a kind of hyper-purist, idealistic notion of, I don't want to do anything or touch anything or use anything that's ever caused any harm to any being anywhere in any way, good luck, because that's not where we are. You can't start from that ideal position, because as a living being, we're living in a web of engagement, relationship, and consumption. We live upon each other's lives, we're affected by each other, we are supporting each other, and we're consuming each other. That's the nature of birth. That's the kind of grimness of the world. The feelings that arise with insight is what they call salok samway, the sober sadness of this living system is violent. It's painful. It's stricken with difficulties. And then just the feeling in the heart of, this is a painful thing that we're part of. In a sense, you're feeling the gears of samsara turning. This is painful, this is difficult. But then allowing that painfulness into the heart, then if that turns us into a neurotic wreck who refuses to speak to any meat eater or has to go and live on a beach and survive on seaweed and windfalls, then you might think, that's the best I can do, but if that, trying to live as simply as possible and harmlessly as possible, if that then makes your mother and your friends will kind of worry about you and turn them into neurotic wrecks, then you know, your effort to be harmless and mindful and cause no difficulty can be causing harm to the people who are nearest and dearest to you. So my encouragement is to not get lost in the idealistic perspective, but to, in a sense, let that painfulness of samsara, let that enter the heart and give rise to compassion for other beings. And recognize, well, we are part of a living web that supports each other, consumes each other, depends on each other, is related to each other. Okay, now what can I do with my speech? What can I do with my actions? What can I do with my way of living that causes as little harm and causes as much benefit as is doable? And recognizing that it's a continual compromise. It has to be. This is where we are. We breathe. We eat. We live in relationship to others. This body lives on the earth. It's an earth body. And when we start from where we are, and just, in a sense, do the best we can, and also not create worry about what we can't do, then we're on the right track. But, and I can really empathize with what they're saying, because I struggled with this throughout my teens. When I was about 11 years old, I was trying to figure this out. And I remember, when I was a novice at Wat Pah Nanachat back in 1978, there was a, usually people came to visit around the meal time, and then the meal was done by about 9 o'clock, 9:30, things were tidied up, people were gone. And I happened to be around the sala, the meeting hall, at about 11, 12 o'clock one day, and this visitor showed up, and no one else was there to talk to him. Even though I was only a novice, I thought, well, I better say hello to this fellow, because he's come to visit the monastery, and the Ajahn wasn't there. And I was always ready to talk to anybody for any reason, being a chatty kind of a person. And he was a military officer, just visiting Wat Pah Nanachat for the first time. And we got chatting together. And so the subject of compassion and caring for all beings and how to live wisely as a human being came up. And I spent most of my life feeling that I should try and help all other beings. And if I wasn't able to help another being stop suffering, their continued suffering was my fault. I assume that. And so anyway, this came up in this conversation with this soldier, and he said, well, I do what I do to help others, and what I can't do, I don't worry about. Because I know that if I could do more, I would do more, but I can't, so I don't. And it was unusual for anybody to speak such good English, but he had pretty good English. And so when he said that, I could feel it's like I was sort of searching for the pigeonhole to put that thought in. I didn't have a pigeonhole. That was completely inconceivable to me. And I could feel this sort of internal sputtering. And then something said, he's right. Wow. I never thought of that. If I could do more, I would do more. But I can't. So, why worry about something I can't do? I know if I could do more, I would. I'm not holding anything back. I'm not being uncaring. I'm not being stingy. So, and then he said, that's amazing. You mean if you can't help somebody else, you don't suffer about that? And he said, well, why would I suffer? Because then you've got two suffering beings instead of one. Wow, what a concept! You know? And it was like so completely matter of fact to him. I thought, that's amazing. So did you figure that out for yourself? No, that's what Buddhism tells you. I didn't invent that. The Buddha said the same thing. It says, karuna is not a state of suffering. Karuna is a brightness in your heart. To me, that was a totally new concept. So, in respect to your question, to finish up with that, that's having confidence that if you could do more, you could do more. If you could live and breathe and function in the world without being connected to any being's suffering. I mean, me just mentioning the electricity or the microphone being made in China, suddenly visions of sweatshops and people sort of slaving over desks with inhaling mercury fumes. Oh no, not that as well. Another thing I'm going to suffer about, I feel awful over. Well, you know, you also have to consider, you know, the Buddha's way of relating to sila is, you know, being a vegetarian is not a requirement. You know, for many vegetarians, they say, well, it's against the first precept to eat meat. But no. I mean, personally, I incline towards vegetarian food, you know, generally. If I have a choice, that's what I will choose. But the Buddha's teaching, as I know, is that putting a knife to the neck of an animal and cutting it is very, very different than taking a mouthful of chicken soup. You know, that what you have to do to your heart to deliberately take the life of another creature is very, very different than consuming some food which has got animal product in it. And that, so, as far as the Buddhist precepts are concerned, they say, no, it's not the same. Yeah, it's, you can say that I don't want to eat meat, or I don't like the idea that this came from a chicken, or and that I would rather the chicken lived, but it's not the same. And so what is actually defined, say, within the Buddhist precepts, it's like you can say, well, the big corporations, they're stealing the livelihood and the lives of the people working in the factories that made the microphone. And that's adinadana, that's theft. I'm breaking the second precept if I use this microphone. No. If I stole the microphone, say, well, I'm going to take this. It doesn't belong to the BIA anymore, it belongs to me. That would be adinadana, and I wouldn't be a monk anymore. But according to the Buddhist precepts, it's skillful, it's wholesome to consider, well, where did this come from? What am I contributing to? That's a kusala thought, that's a wholesome and noble thought, but what's actually a bad karma and that creates, you know, a negative result within you is an act of theft, an act of killing. And it takes a bit of time to put your attention on that and consider those. But those guidelines about the precepts, I feel, are incredibly helpful. Because I lived in California for 15, 20 years, so I know the degree to which people torture themselves. They never torture another creature, but they torture themselves over ethical issues like that. And I find it's extremely skillful and helpful teaching of the Buddha to draw those lines as a clear delineation of what is actually bad karma in terms of the precepts, and what you consider what would be wholesome Buddhist is not like anything that's directly destructive. So it's up to us as individuals to choose our own standards, but the precepts are a really good guideline. And so if you want to look for guidance in your life about what you should do, what you shouldn't do, just ask, okay, am I actually stealing this? Will I get arrested for using this microphone? No. Okay. So let's not consider that a dina dana. Okay. Yeah. Am I actually killing this animal? If I drink some tea with some milk in it, is that the same as holding the knife to the throat of the calf and cutting it? No, it's just a cup of tea with some milk in it. It's not the same. And then, even if part of you is saying, yeah, it is the same, it is. And, yeah, okay, it's good to listen to that. But if we want to use the Buddha's teachings as a guideline, then I would encourage that, well, the Buddha's take on it is that that's not the same. And that just drinking some milk is not the same as killing an animal, according to the Buddha's perspective. So, consider that, weigh that up. And then when you use those guidelines for conduct and see that compromise is inevitable, but you can find that in a way that there's a peacefulness that we find, that we recognize, yeah, well, how could it not be? Yeah. The Buddha ate. The Buddha wore clothing. The Buddha engaged with society. He was a totally enlightened being, but he lived in relationship to the world. And rather than finding a freedom that pushes the world away and says, I'm not going to have anything to do with you, I'm leaving, I'm gone, I'm out. You know. The Buddha touched the earth, and touching the earth with his enlightenment is saying, there is a body here. It needs to eat, it needs to breathe. It lives, it comes from a family in Kapalawatu. I have a father, I have a son, I have a former wife, I have brothers, sisters, cousins. I live on the planet. I live in India. Here it is. So that recognition, touching the earth, was saying, look, we have a body, we have a life, we have a family, we have a world that we're a part of. And then when we, and the mysterious thing is when we embrace that, when we accept that, then we find ourselves free of it. When we push it away and say, no, that's going to make me impure, that's bad, that's wrong, I don't want to eat. I want to be a breatharian or a light area, just living on light. Which some people do, you know, they don't want to eat food, drink water, just living on light. Then I say that's a kind of grasping and unhelpful. And if we follow the Buddha's example, then we find that when we accept the conventions of the world and know them as that, then we can find ourselves not bound or limited by them. So on that note, by the convention of time, it's now 8:05, so we're 5 minutes over the limit. So I'll draw things to a close at that point.
Actually, according to the schedule, it's until 8:30.
Oh, okay.
It's up to you.
Okay, so we've got plenty of time. So please consider you have another 25, according to the new convention, or the correct convention, you have 25 more minutes. Co-abbot, so there was a Bangkok monastery for 14 years. Ajahn Pasano and myself were the co-abbots of a Bangkok monastery. And the reason why this we adopted this form of having two heads was because I had been going to visit California every year since 1990. So it was kind of my project to start a branch monastery there. So I knew the people, I was connected to the committee and the students there. And then just before we opened the monastery, then Ajahn Fasno approached me, and he was the abbot of Wat Pah Nanachat at that time. But he was interested to leave Thailand because he's from Canada. He'd been in Thailand 23 years. And he was still waiting for his body to adapt to the climate. And that hadn't happened, so the hot weather was really burdensome for him. And also he found he was getting more and more drawn into being a kind of pakuyai, a senior monk, and having to spend time going to Bangkok and going to meetings and being part of the official administrative structure. And he had this feeling, I didn't become a monk to go to local committee meetings of administrative monks. And the longer I stay in Thailand, the more this is going to happen. So he's a real nakpatipa, kind of practice monk. And he saw that the only way he could carry on in the way he wanted to was outside of Thailand. He said, but the problem is, I'm senior to everybody. And to move into a monastery that's already established will be difficult for any of the other abbots. But you haven't opened, this place in California is about to begin. So he said, would it be okay if I came to California and helped you? And my response was, okay. It's much more than okay. That's really incredibly helpful. But he was 5 years senior to me, so five more months after than me. So then we thought about it, and so I had an experience of this Chinese monastery, this great meditation master, Master Xuanhua, who was very friendly with Ajahn Sumedho. There's also a Vinaya tradition monastery and a Jatanga tradition, an ascetic monastery, tradition monastery from China. And this teacher was based in San Francisco, and he and Nongpo Sumedho were very good friends. And he had told the story how when he was a novice in China, he first trained, he became a novice when he was 18, when his mother died. And he received Pabajan, a novice ordination, at a monastery called Three Conditions Temple in Harbin area in China, northern China. And it had two abbots. And he often told the story of how that these two abbots, they related together with great respect. They had a lot of admiration for each other. They liked to listen to each other's teachings. And they worked together as a team. And so he used that as an example of how good it can be, how Sangha members should work together, and how these two, out of mutual love and respect, they shared the leadership of the monastery together. And every day in his monasteries, at the end of the morning puja, end of the evening puja, they everybody, then you have this little recitation, it says, I bow in respect to the Venerable Su, Lord High Master of Three Conditions Monastery. And then the next one I say, I bow with respect to the Venerable Yen, Lord High Master of Three Conditions Monastery. And so the two of them are given the same title. They're exactly on equal rank. And that every day people, his Master Hua's disciples, would pay respect to these original teachers. So when Ajahn Pasma suggested this to me, or suggested that he could come and help me, I said, well, you know, we could try having a co-abbotship. I'm a kind of an experimental kind of a guy. I like to try things out and see if they work. We thought, well, okay, we'll give it a try and see what happens. And so he was still senior to me, so he would go through the door first and sit in front of me at the food line. But we shared the responsibility equally. So we take it in turns to give Dhamma teachings, we sit side by side. When people bow to us, they bow, they get two for one. They bow in between, and they get both for one shot. Yeah. And it worked really well. And, you know, Ajahn Mahapasa was the abbot of the nearby monastery in Fremont, near San Francisco. He was a Thai monk who was a very good friend and mentor for us. Yeah, he said, you know, in Thailand, they say you can't have two tigers living in the same cage. and he would use this as an example when Lumpo Pasanna and myself would come to visit Wat Pah Nanachat. And he'd say, well, this is a really good example. Because also, you know, many of you will be aware that there can easily be jealousy between monasteries. What a concept. And Kamicha. And that the different ajahns will try to kind of put each other down, or make the other look bad, or criticize the other, and compete, competition. And Ajahn Mahapasa, he was very non-competitive. And so when we started our monastery, he was very happy. This is great. Because none of my disciples are interested in meditation. That looks at what Buddhadāsa might talk about. They want to have ceremonies and to make merit, but they don't want to not govern. But your disciples, they want to meditate. So I can help you to start your monastery and get that going. So that's great. So he was really happy to help us. And so he was someone who was trying to encourage that quality of non-competition, of mutual respect, and non-jealousy within the Sangha. And so when Lord Pahasana and I would go to Buddhadāsa, he would often talk about that within his Dhamma talks. He'd say, yeah, in Thailand we have this expression, you can't have two tigers living in one cave. But Ajahn Pahasana, Ajahn Amaro, they prove this is not true. Because they're two tigers and they live in the same cave. So, but you have to have the right mixture of personalities. And so, but it's very interesting because I think there's a few people here who have been to Amaravati or know Lumpur Pasano quite well. Quite a few of you. Yeah, quite a few. And you know, there were different personalities. So he's very quiet and shy. And I'm all mouth. As they say in the English expression, all mouth and makeup. Kind of loud, talkative, extrovert. Ajahn Pahasana is shy, quiet, introvert. When he was a teenager, he had ulcers because he was so anxious. He had just anxiety, just shyness. He wouldn't think it now, but even though they're very different personalities, we had a very, very compatible view on Dhamma, on Dhamma practice. And that's the important thing. If your personality is the same, but your view on practice is different, no way. It's not going to work. But because we had a very compatible view about Dhamma practice, then the fact we had very different personalities, people they enjoyed. They would say that, because he was like, one of the novices pointed out right at the beginning, he said, he is like Pa Sano. And you're Amaro, Pa and Ma, Mom and Dad. So Ajahn Pahasana, when people wanted to do something, they come and ask Ajahn Pahasana, and he say, no. But Dad, no, you can't. So then they come and ask me, and I say, yeah, sure, why not? But also, it's very good because we learn to always consult. And that when you have a partnership like that, it's like kind of a marriage. It's like a kind of marriage without the difficult bits, you know. That you have to consult with the other. That when someone says, Ajahn, can we do this? You say, well, I have to talk with Ajahn Pahasana. Or I have to talk with Ajahn Amaro. And so then you are always sharing your decisions. And you're sharing the load. So I found it was a very, very good model. And when I was invited to come to England, the both of us had the same feeling at that time, which was, oh. You know, that we were enjoying working together. And I was very happy to help Lumpo Sumedho and to enable him to step down and to retire. So I was glad to be able to do that. But I really enjoyed working together with Ajahn Pahasana. And so both of us, that was a little heartbreak, but it's okay. We know how to work with our feelings. And also I think today, is today Tuesday? Monday. So Tuesday. Tomorrow, the Ajahn Jayanto goes to the east coast of America to start a new monastery in New Hampshire, Boston area. And so, and he also wants to have a co-abbotship in Ajahn Anando. So they're going to try the same thing over there. Because he can see that it really worked very well, by theory. But we'll see how it works out in, on the East Coast. I caught my hair. The future's uncertain, but we'll see. But I always felt it's like carrying a table. It's less than half the work if two people do it. If you try to carry a table on your own, it's really kind of awkward and difficult. There's two of you, it's very easy. So I always feel it's to have a co-abbotship like that is less than 50% of the work for each of us.
So Ajahn said about the convention and to go beyond convention, like Lopal Sumedho often said Mahayana or Theravada, just it's a wood. So my personal practice is that I have been under Ajahn Chah's guidance for well over 10 years now. And recently there is a Vishnathan Plum Village Sangha here in Thailand as well. And so I joined many retreats, and you mentioned about touching the earth. So I just found that by the combination or mingle the two practice, the Theravada and Mahayana together, I just found that my heart is just so soft and open up to Dhamma more. And so my sharing is that if we are open to either Tibetan Buddhism or Zen, and my heart just goes for it when I listen to the Tibetan drums or sound, as well as the Vietnamese chanting or Theravada chanting, it's like, it's all so beautiful. And so when we practice it, should we just limit ourselves just to one, this chanting, Theravada chanting, Arahant Sama, Prabhupada, Vipapata, in a slow way, or as sometimes listen to like Om Mani Padme Hum, it could also make my heart kind of open and happy and like a Dhokis like that. So can we combine or should we just go for it? Okay, this is it. Theravada, you have to stay with it.
Well, the Buddha's method is practical. The Buddha was a pragmatician rather than a theoretician. So like a doctor is a clinician who's curing patients. It's not just about theory. And theory has its place, but the Buddha Dhamma is about, it's like a doctor, what cures the patient? So if it works, it's like if you go to the doctor, you realize you're sick. You say, I only want this particular kind of treatment. And the doctor says, well, if you don't take the antibiotics, but if instead you have this acupuncture, it'll be much better for you because you don't need the antibiotics, according to my understanding. It'd be much better if you had some massage and acupuncture. He said, no, I want the antibiotics. I don't want massage, don't want acupuncture. I only want this. Well, actually, that's not going to help you. And the massage will, and the acupuncture probably will be a benefit. No, I only want this. I only want one kind of treatment. And I said, okay, the doctor goes, okay, well, that's not going to help you. This will, but if that's what you want, fine. It's your business. So, what that means is that we can limit ourselves just because of an idea. So I only want, if it hasn't come out of the Pali canon, I don't want it. That's fine, that's our choice. We say, I only want it if it's come out of the Lotus Sutra. Nothing but the Lotus Sutra. That's the one true teaching, everything else is extra. Yeah, Nishiren said, I think the disciple of Nishiren in Japan, Nishiren said the Lotus Sutra is everything. The entire Dhamma is the Buddha is contained in the Lotus Sutra. Nothing else matters. This supersedes every teaching. Okay, So what about the Four Noble Truths? Doesn't matter. No, everything that's in the Lotus Sutra is the only thing that matters. Okay, so you're not interested in the Four Noble Truths, the Eightfold Path? No, 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 that's just Theravada nonsense. Only the Lotus Sutra, that's everything that matters.
Okay.
You know, so you can cling to a particular view and limit yourself. Or you can say, listen to various teachings, various teachers, and try things out, and if it works, then why not use it? It's my particular view. So I've always been very liberal. So that book that I was criticized for was my commentaries on the Theravada, from the Theravada background on Tibetan teachings. Because I was co-leading a retreat with a Tibetan Rinpoche. We led a retreat together for 10 days. The first time we had the Tibetan Lama teaching Dzogchen meditation, Theravada monk leading an event together, probably for like 1,000 years, since Nalanda University in India, before the Muslim invasions. So probably, you know, I'm not making a kind of credential out of it or making a badge for myself. So
you still have that book potential?
Yeah. That's a small boat, great mountain, is that book. Yeah. It's online. You can read tonight.
Yeah. Thank you.
So, you know, my own background is very pluralist and liberal. So it doesn't mean that people who are, oh, this is the one true teaching, you must follow this. I'm not saying that they're wrong, but to me, if the main principle is, if it works, it's the right thing. And if you try it out and you see it brings benefit, you can't say it doesn't bring benefit. It's like someone who says, you know, goes to the doctor and the doctor treats you and say that it's really the antibiotics that you need, but you're convinced that you don't want that, you want the massage and the acupuncture. And the doctor says, well, just take these two pills as well. And you take the antibiotics too, and they help you and say, well, no, it was actually the acupuncture that cured me. Well, I did give you some antibiotics, but no, it was the acupuncture and the massage. That's what made me better. Right? Okay, if you want to believe that, that's okay. But you know, the other medicine was there in the mixture too, and it might be that was the thing that made the difference. But we can hang on to our belief. No. I only want to be treated by this kind of medicine, all the rest is rubbish. Even though the other medicine, the antibiotics, was actually what cured him. So we can be convinced, have the idea, that's useless, it won't help me. And even though it would help you a lot, you can, you know, you're free to shut the door, it's fine, it's your business. But if we are open-minded, we recognize, okay, well, maybe that did help me. And maybe I need to change my view, because before I believed that I couldn't do anything, couldn't help me, but it seems that it did. Oh, look at that. And that when we open our minds to other traditions, other practices, other trainings, we can see that there are many different things that can help us and be valuable to us. Yeah. And so, for myself, if you have a mind that can easily integrate things, like you can integrate the Anapanasati and Metta Bhavana, or you can integrate Kayanavasana and Vipassana meditation, you know, you can bring those different things together, or you can visit Thich Nhat Hanh and read his books or do practices. Thich Nhat Hanh and follow Lumbu Cha as well. If you can integrate those well, fine, no problem. If you are more of a doubting type, Kee Son Sai, and you see that trying to bring things together just brings confusion, then that's the thing to notice. Okay? Well, I want to bring these things together, but I just end up in a big mess. It's just I get confused. Should I anapana or metta or kayana prasana or should I be touching the earth, or, you know, are we into being, or non-being, or anatta, or what? Then you realize, okay, unplug. Just take one thing and do that. Because you have to know your own personality, your own insight, and you get to see what works for you. So for myself, I find I can easily integrate things. So, you know, I've done practices from Theravada tradition, from Chinese tradition, from Tibetan tradition, Japanese tradition, anyway. And it's no problem for me to put them together without any confusion, and I find it's useful. Other people are like, oh, it's unacceptable and wrong view, and it's kind of corrupting and foolish. They may even hear the recording of this talk and go, oh, he did what? That's okay. Yeah, but, you know, Master Xuanhua, who I was mentioning, who spoke about those monks, the reason I know of him is because Lumpur Sumedho was taken to meet him back in 1981. He didn't really want to see him, but a student of his, of Lumpur Sumedho's, said, you know, there's this Chinese monk, and you've got to meet him, you've got to meet him. If you see any other monk in the Bay Area, you've got to meet this monk. And Lumpur Sumedho had these memories when he was a student at Berkeley in the 50s. He went to some Chinese temples to try and learn meditation and learn about Buddhism, and they just kind of pushed him away and shut the door and weren't interested. So he thought, oh, Chinese monk. But when he met him, he realized, oh, this is different. And what he said was, up to that point, I assumed that there was only one monk like Lumpur Chah in the world. Now I know there's two. So very high praise. And then also Master Hua said, it was always the dream of my life to bring the northern and southern traditions together again. He wouldn't say Mahayana Theravada, he said northern and southern, because he really didn't see a big difference. He saw Vinaya was the same, and the Dhamma practice was the same. He said, and I never thought I was going to be able to do it until I met Sumedho. So he had a tremendous respect for Lumpur Sumedho, and the half of the land of Abhayagiri Monastery was donated by him. So just before he died, he donated 120 acres of forest to help us start the monastery. And so it's about 20 miles from his big monastery. But really interesting, you know, he made that statement, I'd like to bring the northern and southern traditions together again. So when he gave that land, there were no conditions attached. It wasn't like, you have to practice in this way, you must practice in that way, we've got to join together, we've got to do nothing. Just, here's a gift. Please, do it as you like. So he showed great faith in our practice and made no conditions about how we should live or what we should do. So that was a kind of royal gift. There were no strings attached, nothing in return. And so naturally that brings the greatest respect. And so I felt very honored by that gift, and also the spirit of inclusion that was within that. And I felt for the West, that's a very helpful thing, to be open and friendly with other traditions. And so the name of Ajahn I chose because it's the name of an ancient monastery in Sri Lanka. And it was famous in its own time. It was there from about 2,000 years ago. And it was known as a place that welcomed all the different Buddhist traditions. So Theravada, Mahayana, Vajrayana, everybody practiced there together. So it was known as a spiritual kind of meeting place. So that was why I chose the name. to respect Master Hua's offering, and also because in China they have many bhikshuni, five times as many nuns as monks. Five times as many. If you look at Taiwan or Hong Kong, there's for every 100 monks, there are 500 nuns. So at Master Hua's monastery also many, many bhikshuni. But the lineage of bhikshuni in China originally came from Sri Lanka, 1,600 years ago, from Sri Lanka in the year 432. A boat took a group of Theravada bhikkhuni to China to start the bhikkhuni ordination in China. And so all the nuns in China originally are Theravada. And the nuns from Sri Lanka, they came from Lankarama, which was a nun's branch of Abhayagiri, the original Abhayagiri monastery. So they were the missionaries to China. They came from the Abhayagiri route. So that was another reason why I chose the name for that monastery. So it's Theravada tradition, but also the connection to China. Okay? Now we really are 5 minutes past. So the convention is the big hand is on the seventh. So that means 5 minutes over the time. So
just before we end, though, I'd just like to say that Ajahn Amaro is leading a 5-day silent retreat starting tomorrow. This has been a wonderfully inspiring and joyful evening. If anybody has the least little bit of an idea that you'd like to join us tomorrow, it's very, very possible. There are 15 places that are available. If this retreat was happening in England, I think it would have been oversubscribed within the first week that it was announced. So please take full advantage of this opportunity, and you can take a piece of paper from outside. It's very easy. Please come.
Okay, so that concludes our session tonight, and on behalf of VAA and everyone here in this room, I would like to express our heartfelt gratitude to Venerable Ajahn for the wonderful and inspiring Dhamma talk. And we have a representative on behalf of VAA to present to you a gift. May I ask Ajahn Mili, Vice Assistant to Abbot Wat Pah Nanachat, so more to present a gift to Venerable Ajahn Amaro. Please. Travel expenses, and please enjoy yourself with the snacks and hot drinks before you leave. So, now please join Ajahn's leads to pay respect to the Triple J.